faithfully execute the office of President of the United States.
That I will faithfully execute the office.
Power is a lot like real estate. It's all about location, location, location. The closer you are to the source, the higher your property value. Centuries from now, when people watch this footage, who will they see smiling just at the edge of the frame?
So help me God.
Congratulations.
Today is not about the next 4 years. It's about the next 4 decades. Now you've placed your faith in me, and I, in turn, choose to place that faith in our children. Our children are the key to this nation's future. And that's why the first order of business for this administration will be a comprehensive education reform bill to properly fix, finance, and strengthen our nation's schools. And I pledge to you, we will have that bill on the floor of the Congress within the first 100 days of this administration.
There's a couple of them wanting to nail me, and other ones did, but nobody speaks up. But I'll go through this over and over. Sometimes I just wonder, I don't know. You learn to take patience, because everything, it takes time. In prison, you gotta wait. Nothing happened just like that. Anyway, they couldn't take away my love for my family then. I never had bad hopes. No, it was always good hopes.
In the Middle East, Carter just won the Nobel Prize. His great achievement was the Camp David Agreements. The Camp David Agreements are presented as a diplomatic triumph for the United States. In fact, they were a diplomatic catastrophe. At Camp David, the United States and Israel accepted, finally, Egypt's 1971 offer, which they had then, U.S. had rejected at the time, except that now it was worse from the U.S.-Israeli point of view because it included the Palestinians. In order to get Israel to accept Egypt's 1971 offer after a major war and atrocities and so on, Carter raised aid, military and other aid to Israel to more than 50% of total aid worldwide. Israel used it at once in exactly the way they said they were going to do, as every sane person knew, as an opportunity to attack their northern neighbor, first in 1978, then in 1982, and to increase integration of the occupied territories. And that's for starters. We can continue.
Reagan?
I don't think we have to talk about that one either. I mean, Reagan is the first president to have been condemned by the International Court of Justice for what they called the unlawful use of force, meaning international terrorism, in the war against Nicaragua. Again, that's just for starters. The Security Council endorsed it in 2 resolutions, both of which were vetoed by the United States.
Bush won.
Well, we can begin with the invasion of Panama. The invasion of Panama, which, according to the Panamanians, killed about 3,000 people, since it's never investigated. We don't know if that's true or not. This was done in order to kidnap a disobedient thug who had been supported by the United States right through his worst atrocities.
Noriega.
He was brought to Florida and tried for crimes that he committed mostly on the CIA payroll. Okay, that's aggression. We could go into the details of the war in Iraq, but there were plainly opportunities for, they might not have worked, we don't know, but there were opportunities for diplomatic settlement, which the Bush administration refused to consider. And incidentally, the press would not report, with a single exception, and Long Island Newsday, which did report the whole story throughout accurately, and is the only newspaper in the country to have done so. Bush administration then did attack, and the attack was carried out in a manner which is criminal under the laws of war. They attacked infrastructure. I mean, if you attack New York City and you destroy the electrical system, the power system, the sewage systems, and so on, that amounts to biological warfare, and that's the nature of the attack. Then came a sanctions regime, which it's mostly Clinton, but began with Bush, which is, by conservative estimates, killed hundreds of thousands of people while strengthening Saddam Hussein. That takes us off to Clinton, which, that's the beginning, but that's by no means the end. We can run through that one case suffices.
All right.
But there are plenty of others.
Bush too?
Let's go on with Clinton.
Okay.
And one of Clinton's minor escapades, very minor, was sending a couple of cruise missiles to the Sudan to destroy what they knew to be a pharmaceutical plant. There was no intelligence failure. According to the only estimates we have from the German ambassador and the regional director of Near East Foundation, who does field work in Sudan, both of them estimate several tens of thousands of deaths from one cruise missile attack. It's pretty serious. If somebody did that to us, we'd regard it as bad news. And again, we can continue. In the Middle East, for example, Clinton began by declaring past UN resolutions, in the words of his administration, obsolete and anachronistic. Okay, so we're finished with that. No more international law. Then comes a period called a peace process, except that during the peace process, Israeli settlement, which means settlement paid for by the U.S. taxpayer and supported by U.S. military aid and diplomacy, continually increased. The most extreme year was Clinton's last year, the highest level of settlement, the highest since 1992. Meanwhile, the territories were cantonized, broken up into small regions with infrastructure projects and new settlement. I don't know what you call that, but it's under military occupation. And if anyone else was doing it, we'd call it a war crime. And again, we can continue.